So what I'm going to try and do now for the next 15 minutes is go through a little bit about sequence variation and how it can help us focus especially on the flanking regions or STRs. So we know that using massively parallel sequencing has potentially many benefits. We know that the mitochondria are very useful. We know that we can analyze many marks simultaneously, which is what various people talked about yesterday. It gives us new ways to look at different types of markers like RNA and methylation. And also it gives us the possibility of looking at all sorts of different species at the same time, so not just looking at human DNA, but also being able to look at the entire genome, so bacteria, viruses, fungi, etc. But STR analysis is new ways to look at different types of markers like RNA and sequence variation. Normally we have an STR, we have a single peak. But we know that that is actually composed of many thousands, millions of different PCR amplicons all migrating at the same time. And what we can see is that we have this repeating unit within this STR, so this ATCT, ATCT, and we can see that this is the sequence we're getting. So if we think about something like D2, what we would expect is that for allele 9, we would have 9 repeats, for allele 15, we would have 15 repeats. And if we look at it by sequence as opposed to by size, we see that allele 9, we do indeed have 9 TCTA repeats. But for allele 10, we have two different versions, one with 10 TCTAs and one that has a TCTG, but is just very light on here, but I'll cross you in there. Same for allele 11, we've got two versions. For allele 12, we have three different versions, so we've got 12 TCTAs, then we've got 10 TCTAs, one TCTG, the TCTA, and down here we've got 9, then this different repeat unit again, and then a couple more. So we have many different versions by sequence than we were by size, which is not surprising, this is what we've been discussing a little bit over the last couple of days. And if you look at different markers, we can see that there are some markers like D12, like D2, D21, where we're getting a lot of sequence variation. But what we also know is that if this is where our repeat region is, it's not surprising, this is what we've been discussing a little bit over the last couple of days. And if we look at different markers, we can see that there are some markers like D12, like D2, D21, where we're getting a lot of sequence variation. But what we also know is that if this is where our repeat region is, it's not surprising, this is what we've been discussing a little bit over the last couple of days. And if we look at different markers, we can see that there are some markers like two alleles within populations, an A and C, and something like in an East Asian population, that's about a 50-50 split. So we have a very useful split that is just outside of the region. So what would this do? So this is a representation of allele frequency. So this is D16. These are all of the different alleles we can see by size. So you can see that allele 11 is the most frequent, allele 8, 15, 16, they're the rare ones. So if this is the frequency we get when we look at it in length based, when we look at it with our sequence based, so this was the frequency sequence based, so this was the different frequencies. What we can see here is that if we have this 50-50 SNP, so if we had a SNP that we expected was going to give us 50-50 two different versions, what we would hope is that all of these alleles, we would have two versions, and we would immediately be halving our own frequencies for all of them. So, ideally, this would be very useful. Unfortunately, this is what we see in practice. So, what we see is that actually there are two versions of the 9 allele, there are two versions of the 10 allele, two versions of the 11 allele, two versions of the 12 allele, but in no way are we getting a 50-50 split. We're getting, instead, not much improvement. And why is that? Well, the reason is that for this SNP, we've got two alleles, but one of the alleles is predominantly associated with only the 9 and 10 repeats, whereas the other allele is associated predominantly with the 11, 12, 13, etc. So what we're finding is that we actually have very strong linkage between the SNP, or the particular allele of the SNP, and the particular repeat, so the particular allele. Which means that actually these are nearly as useful as we would have hoped. So this is another example, this is D2. These are the length-based alleles. This is what happens when we look at the sequence, so the peak region variation. And this is what happens when we look at the flanking region variation. So again, we're getting really only in this 11 are we getting any increased discrimination. So, we know that the consequences of increased sequence variation are that we would have better discrimination. If we do have better frequencies, that means that we should be able to get better results with things like partial profiles, because alleles will be more rare in the population. It would enhance kinship analysis, and it would make mixture analysis better. So really what we need to work out is whether looking at these flanking regions, where we're getting much less variation than we thought we were, is still useful. Well, it certainly is useful for some things. So this is looking at if we can use STRs to predict ancestry. So back in 2016, Rosenberg showed that using standard 13 coded set of markers, that the ancestry information you got was comparable to just a random marker set. And that actually you needed many, many more STRs to be able to do discrimination or ancestry interpretation from STRs. So this is a structure plot. We saw some structure plots yesterday. And all you can see is the 13 coded loci. This and here are the European populations. We've got some African populations, some Asian populations, some Native American populations. And you can see that we're not getting very much differentiation. And really you need 779, is what they've used, 779 STRs to be able to get a better differentiation between these populations. And even there, all of these Asian ones in the middle are coming out the same. So, what happens if we use STRs with sequence alleles and with flanking regions? Well, this is what happens if we just look at two populations that we know are very hard to differentiate. So that's our white British population, our white European population, and South Asian population. Again, to remind you about these structure diagrams, every line is an individual, and here we've asked the program to try to find two different genetic structures within it. So it's like one of them red and one of them blue. And ideally, this will be blue and this will be red. And you can see that when we look at normal length-based analysis of STRs, this is not what we get. We get something that's very similar. If instead we look at the sequence-based alleles, so these repeat regions that are different, what we can see now is that we are indeed getting better discrimination between our two populations. And very nicely, if we actually use the planking region alleles, we can see that they are quite population specific, and we are now getting much, much better differentiation as we've gone down between populations. So potentially these planking region variants actually could be quite useful to us, but maybe not in the ways we were thinking. So certainly maybe for ancestry analysis they could be quite interesting. But how about for kinship analysis? So both Daniel and Lucilla showed us some plots yesterday, and indeed there was another one as well. This is an example. This shows 5,000 simulations, and these are unrelated individuals, so they should all be below zero. And this is looking at half siblings versus unrelated. So this is a normal distribution of unrelated individuals. This is a distribution of half siblings, genuine half siblings. So once again, we would hope that these would be above a log of zero. So this is what happens when we have length-based allele frequencies, and this actually is the graph we showed yesterday, just with slightly less attractive colours. And what we can see is that as we indeed do look at sequence-based alleles, we get better separation. So the issue is, if we look at planking region allele variation, does this separation increase? Well, it does, but very, very slightly. I mean, this curve is virtually on top, and there is a very, very slight increase here. So potentially, we may get some benefit from using planking region variation on STLs, but it's going to be very minimal. What I could talk about now for the next half hour, and hopefully I won't, is that one of the big problems with using planking region variation in STLs is temperature. So it's how we actually label STLs, because if we have planking region variation, it's everything much more complicated to be particular stuff and stop points. So potentially, given the limited use of these planking variations, it may be that maybe they have specific uses in specific cases, but mainly if we're going to use massive comparative sequencing to look at STRs, focusing on repeat region only could be a much simpler way to go to make everyone's life easier. So, in conclusion, STR sequences analysed in general, repeat region variation in particular, can be highly useful to casework situations. There is a linkage between STR sequence fields and planking region SNPs. And we should consider whether we really want to report STR planking region variation, because the problems outweigh the benefits. Planking region variation can be useful, though, when incorporated into other applications such as ancestry. I'd like to thank Laurent, Susan, for Denise, and if you have any questions, I am happy to.